Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace. Welcome to the soul of Sunday. We are Unitarian Universalists. Ours is an historic faith with a progressive theology. We affirm the worth and dignity of every being, and that we are all deeply interconnected. We are bound to one another not by creed, but by covenant, and we are called to love with open minds, open hearts, and open hands. Whoever you are, those of all nations, all creeds, all colors, all kinds of love, you are welcome here.
We are excited to have Reverend Erica Rose Long as our guest preacher today. Reverend Erica is an affiliate minister at Arlington Street Church and a spiritual care provider at Massachusetts General Hospital. Welcome, Erica, and thank you for putting this service together for us. I'm so happy we can be here Zooming to worship together. We're doing an awesome job of staying together while we're apart. Thanks again and again to our extraordinary tech team. Rich Abreu, Sandy Dixon, Frank Lee, Jonah Buchman, Art Nava, and Barb Seidel. They're making it all possible. If you haven't already downloaded today's order of service, there's a link in the chat, and it's also available on the homepage at ascboston.org. All of the hymn lyrics are included in the order of service and will be posted in the chat so we can sing together. And now please say hello in the chat as we continue our virtual greetings. As soon as we finish our initial hellos, we will sing our first hymn, number 170, We Are a Gentle, Angry People. Let's engage that Arlington Street spirit of welcome that transcends social distance as we greet one another heart to heart.
Gentle, angry people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a gentle, angry people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a justice seeking. Singing, singing for our lives. We are a justice-seeking people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are young and old together, and we are singing, singing. Gentle, loving people, and we are singing, singing for our lives.
It is now time for our treasured ritual of sharing community candles of sorrow and joy. These candles were submitted at ascboston.org. If you didn't submit your candle and have one you'd like to share this morning, I invite you to type it into the chat. In addition to sharing our sorrows and joys this morning, let's reach out to one another in the week ahead, staying connected. May these times remind us of how very precious beloved community is. Despite having to be apart, may we stay very close. And now, in the spirit of invocation, let's join in singing Sanctuary. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat. Some of us come today with heavy hearts. We open our hearts to you. An anonymous candle of sorrow and concern for a family member facing a scary new diagnosis. A prayer of sorrow for all affected by Laura, the latest hurricane to hit the U.S. We send love to the families of the 6 people killed and the many who are triggered, who are injured, and who have lost their homes. May our nation work together to rebuild and to heal. A final prayer of sorrow and anger as the world watches racism fuel white individuals to forever injure a Black man in Kenosha, Wisconsin. We pray for Jacob Blake, who was paralyzed after being shot in the back 7 times by police. As he recovers in a local hospital, we pray for justice and healing. We pray for the families of Anthony Huber and Joe Rosenbaum, who were protesting Blake's shooting and were killed by 17-year-old Kyle Rittenhouse, who showed up armed to face protesters. As the agony of racism and violence rages through Kenosha and through our country, we pray for legal action that says Black lives matter and gun violence is never acceptable. May we learn from this. May we change our world so that a minor will never again show up with a gun, so that shooting will not be used as an investigation tool. Black lives matter. Some of us come today in joy. We share your joy. Our one spoken candle today is a candle of joy and gratitude for the Operation Never Forgotten search for missing children conducted this week. U.S. Marshals worked alongside local law enforcement to find and rescue 39 missing children in Georgia. We remember and pray for the child who goes missing every 40 seconds in our country. And we especially remember these 39 who have been found and will need endless love and care as they work to heal. All the sorrows and all the joys we hold in our hearts, we light a silent candle to remember and to rejoice. May the peace of our sanctuary enter into our hearts as we share a quiet moment together, breathing our prayers for ourselves, for one another, for our country, and for the world. Amen. Let's join now in saying together the affirmation and covenant of this beloved spiritual community. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is our gift. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to speak our truths in love, and to help one another. El amor es el espíritu de nuestra congregación, y servicio es nuestro regalo. Esto es a lo que nos comprometemos, convivir en paz, hablar nuestras verdades con amor, y ayudarnos los unos a los otros. And now please join in singing hymn number 123, Spirit of Life.
Sopla volar, sopla.
It's the morning, and popular author and psychologist Brené Brown is in her kitchen. She's wearing white slacks and a pink sweater, and she's drinking a big mug of coffee, a very full mug of coffee, when, smash, the mug slips from her hands and hits the tile floor. It shatters, and coffee splashes everywhere, all over Brené's white slacks. As she looks down at her stained clothes, she cries, "Damn you, Steve." Steve is her husband. A millisecond after the mug slipped from her hands, Brené knew it was Steve's fault, and she tells us why. The night before, Steve went to play water polo with some of his friends. Before he left, I said, "Hey, try to be home by 10 because you know I can't sleep until I know you are home." He got back at 10:30, so I went to bed a little later than I had planned, ergo my second cup of coffee that I probably would not have had to have if Steve had gotten home at 10, like we discussed. Therefore, damn you, Steve. How many of us go to that place where when something bad happens, we want to know whose fault it is? I would rather it be my fault than nobody's fault. Why? Because it gives us a sense of control. With this story, Brené identifies herself as a blamer. A blamer quickly assigns blame to move through the discomfort that comes when things go wrong. Brené's story of her spilled coffee is an excellent example of how quickly our minds can put together a story of blame, mere seconds after something goes wrong. As an outside audience, it's funny, right? It's funny to think that when the coffee spills, Brené's first instinct is to blame her husband, who is off at work, far away from her and her coffee. And it's funny because it is relatable. It's hard to go through life and sometimes even a day without creating a ridiculous blame narrative to quickly make sense of a situation. Sometimes the blame falls on another person, sometimes the blame falls on ourselves. Either way, it's hard to prevent this reaction. We crave the satisfaction of understanding why things happen. If you're listening right now and thinking, "Ugh, it's my fault, I'm the ultimate blamer," or if you're listening and thinking, "Well, I don't do that, but I know about five people who do," I invite you to pause, take a breath with me. It's not just you, it's not just them. We are all blamers. Brené goes on to say, here's what we know from the research. Blame is simply the discharging of discomfort and pain. It has an inverse relationship with accountability. Accountability, by definition, is a vulnerable process. It means me calling you and saying, "Hey, my feelings were really hurt by this," and talking it out. It's not blaming. Blaming is simply a way that we discharge anger. Blaming is corrosive in relationships, and it's one of the reasons we miss opportunities for empathy. The instinct to blame is closely related to our desire to make meaning of suffering and to cope with our lack of control. When there is blame, there is a reason, there is causality, and we can understand what happened, or at least so we like to think. We also crave an explanation that validates what we most want to be purely good, whether that is ourselves, someone else, or a higher power. When we blame someone else, we are still good. When we blame ourselves, our loved ones, and our higher power are still good. We don't need to be ashamed of this. It is something we all experience, and yet it is important for us to be mindful of blame when it arises, to notice, as Brené reminds us, if we are missing an opportunity for accountability. Accountability is the fact of being responsible for what you do and able to give a satisfactory reason for it. Most of us strive to do no harm and to prove our inherent goodness. So it can trigger an immense amount of shame when we admit that we are responsible for doing something that has indeed caused harm or failed. As Unitarian Universalists, we believe in the transformative power of love. Love needs us to be accountable for our actions. This is the blessing and the challenge of our faith, to love one another, to be willing to move past our shame and be honest about our feelings and the impact of our actions. When the motivation is love, accountability is not a punishment, but a bridge of connection. These are not new spiritual concepts for us here at Arlington Street Church. If you've been tuning in this summer, you've heard many members of our community preach the the virtues of accountability, vulnerability, trust, empathy, and above all else, love. These are the virtues that guide us in our spiritual work to cultivate our beloved community and to seek justice in our world. We need to be mindful of the moments when we blame, so we don't miss an opportunity to choose accountability and love instead. Blame can happen in the little daily moments when we spill coffee or miss the bus, and it also comes up in times of serious crisis. A few months ago, I went to visit a woman in her later 60s who was recovering from surgery. She told me that after the surgery, everything seemed fine. Then all of a sudden, she began to experience acute pain. Her suffering was so sharp and overwhelming. She looked at me and said, "I know this is ridiculous, but when I was in pain, all I could think was, am I really such a bad little girl that I deserve this?" At the hospital, I meet with people who are struggling to make sense of pain, illness, and grief over and over again. That same question, is it my fault? What did I do wrong? Am I really so bad that I deserve this? I sit with these patients and listen to them describe all the ways that their cancer, their heart failure, their depression, their COVID-19 infections are completely their fault. I hear in their voices a longing for accountability, for a satisfactory reason for their pain. There are times when our actions contribute to illnesses, but I can say with certainty that most of the time, it is not our fault. As a Unitarian Universalist, I do not believe that this is a satisfactory reason for our suffering. I do not believe that the suffering caused by illness is a consequence of poor moral character. Sometimes I wish it were, so that the many kind, loving, and good people I meet in the hospital would not suffer so greatly. Sometimes accountability feels impossible because there's no satisfactory reason for what has occurred. In these moments, blame feels like all we have to make sense of our suffering. Earlier this summer, a friend and I visited the Dogtown Commons in Gloucester, Massachusetts. Dogtown was a settlement founded in 1693. Once a safe haven from pirates and invaders, the inland Dogtown Commons was abandoned in 1830 as settlers moved closer to the seacoast to work in the fishing industry. In the early 20th century, wealthy philanthropist Roger Babson bought the commons, which by then was mostly overgrown wilderness with only a few remnants of the old colonial settlement remaining. Wandering through Dogtown Commons, my friend and I were curious about Babson. After a quick Google search, we learned that Babson founded 4 colleges, including Babson College. He invented the parking meter, and he ran for president of the United States as a member of the Prohibition Party. He was certainly a very educated and brilliant man. But what my friend and I found to be most interesting was that Babson was a founding member of the Gravity Research Foundation, which worked to find a way to block the power of gravity. In an essay describing his aspirations for the foundation, Babson declared that gravity was enemy number one. That's right, gravity, the natural phenomenon that holds our world together, was enemy number one. This sounds a bit eccentric, right? Maybe a little far-fetched, like blaming Steve for the spilled coffee. Gravity was Babson's enemy because he blamed gravity for one of the most heartbreaking moments of his life, the death of his sister. When Babson was a child, his sister drowned. He writes, "She was unable to fight gravity, which came up and seized her like a dragon and brought her to the bottom." His grief was so consuming that he had to blame something. It was too painful to believe that his sister could die for no reason. Along with blaming ourselves and each other, we blame powerful forces that are beyond us. We blame God, the universe, the devil, our ancestors, and even gravity. In our discomfort and distress, finding anything that can be held responsible for our suffering is better than nothing because it gives us a sense of understanding which restores in us some feeling of control. While this may initially be satisfying, Ultimately, it can lead to feelings of apathy, demoralization, and isolation, which are the opposites of love. Our faith calls on us to move toward love in these moments, not away from it. It calls on us to take responsibility for our actions and our feelings, which are within our control. It calls on us to move beyond shame and our fear of being bad. And it also calls on us to accept the scary but nonetheless real fact that there is simply so much in this world that we cannot and do not control. Moving toward love means holding each other and ourselves in the painful mystery of our suffering, being together in the unknown. Right now, we are in the midst of overwhelming grief and crisis in our country and our world. The desire to blame is very strong and very real. Most of us have spent the last 5 anxious and tense months in a small quarantine bubble, cut off from many of the people and activities that usually help us cope with anxiety and stress. And daily, we are witnessing people who are acting recklessly in ways that kill. We are living in a country that values white comfort over Black lives and needs to be held accountable. In this time, there are so many heavy questions on our hearts about our own suffering and the suffering of others. Developing an awareness of blame as a reaction to discomfort, pain, and anger will help us to notice when we have an opportunity to love. It's not about letting one another off the hook when something goes wrong, but rather when something does. Choosing accountability and love over blame and fear. It's about having the nuance to recognize what it is that lies within the bounds of our control and the control of others, and what, like the powerful force of gravity, simply does not. It's about resisting overly easy single-cause answers to some of life's most challenging and painful questions. And it's about being willing to sit in grief and in anger, in mystery and in wonder, marveling at the complexity of it all. One of my colleagues shared this story with me, and I want to share it with all of you. She was called to visit a Catholic priest who was very sick. She asked him, "Father, would you like me to pray for you?" He smiled and said, "I've had one prayer my entire life." "And what is your prayer?" my coworker asked. He replied, "To be more loving." As we move towards autumn filled with fear and hope, I pray that I will choose to be more loving. I pray that we will all choose to be more loving with each other, with ourselves, and with our one precious world. May it be so.
Each of us has the power to make a difference, to do our part to strengthen the safety net that holds us all. Your generous enthusiasm and support for everything Arlington Street is doing to uplift and uphold us, keeping us strong and connected, is deeply appreciated. All of us opening our virtual wallets and giving our hearts continues to make it possible for us to thrive in these difficult days. Each week, we fill the virtual collection plate, and the generosity of this beloved spiritual community never ceases to amaze us. We know these times are hard and are affecting each of us differently. As we continue to live through this pandemic, we are reminded that community is a place to hold each other when we can and be held by each other when we need support. If this is a time when you can give, please take a moment now to text the word GIVE, G-I-V-E, to 617-300-0509. Scan the QR code in the order of service or click on the yellow donate button on the bottom right of the homepage at ascboston.org. Here's that number again, 617-300-0509. Thank you for your generosity. After you make your gift to sustain our beloved community, please continue to share in the chat what inspires you during these difficult days. At the close of today's service during virtual coffee hour, an invitation will appear on your screen inviting you to join a breakout room. This is an opportunity to visit with each other in a smaller, quieter setting. If you click yes, you'll automatically find yourself there. You can just say hello, or you might want to share a thorn or a rose from the past week, what's hard and what's good. Please be sure to leave enough time for everyone to speak. I'll try to get around to each breakout room. After a few minutes, you'll be invited back from your breakout room to say goodbye to everyone. There are so many great moments of connection happening this week in the Arlington Zoom room. Thank you to all who are serving as the host this summer to keep these programs going. A full list of events and links to the Zoom room can be found at ascboston.org. Whether you have been part of our community for decades or whether today is your first service with us, all are welcome at any of our events. Reverend Kim and Reverend Beth invite you to join them for iced tea in the Arlington Street Zoom room this coming Wednesday at 5 o'clock. Bring your own tea. And I'll look forward to seeing you here next Sunday morning for our final summer service when Al Ingram will be preaching his sermon, Finding Your Harmony. Remember, my friends, love is the spirit of this congregation, and we're all in this together. Please join us in singing our final hymn, number 1021, Lean on Me.
Sometimes in our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow, but if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend, I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride if I have things you need to borrow, for no one can fill those of your needs that you won't let show. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend, I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. We just might have a problem that you'll understand. We all need somebody to lean on. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend, I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'd understand. We all need somebody to lean on. If there is a load you have to bear that you can't carry, I'm right up the road, I'll share your load if you just call me. When you need a friend, you just call me.
Our Benedict benediction this morning is the prayer of St. Francis of Assisi. Make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Beloved spiritual companions, the service begins. When the service ends, I love you, I miss you, bless your hearts. Amen.
Where you go, where you go, I will go, beloved. Where you go, I will go. Where you go, I will go, beloved. Where you go, I will go. For your people are my people. Your people are mine. Your people are my people. Your divine, my divine. Where you go, I will go, beloved. Where you go, I will go. Where you go, I will go, beloved. Where you go, I will go. For your people are my people. Your people are mine. Your people are my people. Your divine, my divine.
Visit ascboston.org for more information about this historic Unitarian Universalist congregation. Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace.